Alright guys, I was hitting some estate sales today and I picked up this little gem. It's called the General Electric Show and Tell, and we'll get into that. And I did pay $15 for it. As you can see, it's loaded in dirt. And it has a very sticky switch. It's almost frozen in place. Oh, so anyway, basically the idea, it has an AM radio. You can see it says radio. Well, it's just AM, you can see. Phono, which means you just play a record. It says viewer. Well, when it's in viewer mode, right there, have a little cartridge that, here, see these guys? Alright. It's called the Show and Tell Picture Sound Program. The name of this story is The Fourth Wise Man. Alright? So, alright, so basically there's your record, which is your story. It says The Fourth Wise Man. And then you have your little cartridge, this guy, that goes down inside there. And as the record plays, it advances this cartridge up, giving you an image through the screen here. The best that I can deduce is this is from the early 60s. And the only reason why I think that is because the record says 1964 right there. So we're going to give this a little bit of a clean up, and I'm going to spray some old contact cleaner inside the switch and the volume knob and see if the record player actually makes sound. I know it spins, but I don't know what the condition of the needle is. We're going to get some cleaning agent on here. Jeez, wow, it's gross. So anyway, yeah. We got, how many of these did we get? So we have Donald Duck, Mickey Mouse, see the header right there, Christmas Carol, Red Riding Hood, I'm pulling them out of a bag, the Pied Piper, Christmas Chimes, and I think we have two more, and that is the Nativity and the Jungle Book. So yeah, we'll go through some of these, but first off, I guess let's get some cleaning going on this thing. Wow, is it disgusting. Alright guys, in order to really do a nice job getting into these switches with this contact cleaner here, I had to remove two screws, this one and this one. Because, I don't know if you're going to feel it, but look at this. Oh my gosh. So as you can see, that's not acceptable. So we're going to drop this down. Let's have a good look inside there and see what makes this thing tick. Be right back. All right. As you can see, there's a mirror, which I'm going to go ahead and hit with some Windex when it gets time to do that. But the first thing I want to do is make sure that these switches are all working. So as you can see, there is a light bulb around here somewhere. Not sure what that is. I'm trying to see here. A simple little motor for the record player. And I know there is a light bulb in here because you access it through the top right there. And that's filthy, so real mirror, not plastic. But we'll give that a good cleaning too. And there's also a focus switch on the side there too. But first things first, I want to hit all of these switches and knobs, these potentiometers, with some contact cleaner. And let me see if I can get you in the movie here. How do I get access to that? Can I get access just like this? No. Of course not. That would be too easy. Alright. Let's not fret about it. Let me grab the proper tool for this. Lift this board up so I can actually get access to that switch. Alright, I'm in the process of removing this board so I can get access to that selector switch. Because I certainly can't get access from this side of the board. But it looks like I can get access to this volume pot right there. I'll grab some knobs off of here. All right. Douglas just grabbed the bezel, and he's going to go clean the bezel. I'm still working on getting access to... Okay, get that there. Start spinning this switch here. This is the on and off switch plus volume. Okay. Let's see if we can get access to this damn thing. Wow, they really got that, That's funny. Now it's moving. And I didn't spray anything in it. Getting easier. That's for sure. Get better access to that. Better access, he says? Yeah, you know, better access, see? Oh, there we are. Maybe we can just get this thing off and give it another tape job. Comes time to do that very thing. So brittle. Come on. Come on. There. Now it looks like I can really get down inside there and do a number on it. Coming to this side. Repeat. Alright. Let's see how it works. See if we get any sound out of this needle. See, we already know the radio works, so. Alright, guys, I'm in the process of putting this thing back together. And I did a quick. No, I didn't really paint it very well. But I cleaned all of the inside, the mirror, more importantly. Control switch and the spit it out, Kevin, and the on and off potentiometer, and we're gonna do a little more cleaning. Now I'm confident that some 97% alcohol will remove this piece of old masking tape, and so let's just give it a quick. Here's your on and off switch.
Connected to just
here's your radio switch. It's on AM.
It just, Bulls record hasn't been great. Just gonna roll to about the 15s, gobbled up right there. Bulls game.
skilled Mercedes-Benz technicians, and it's all backed by an unlimited.
Out today to town and family, and happy birthday.
LS 890 AM.
Delves into many different
issues. Let's take a look at the top 25 sports.
Yeah, so the radio's working, and our switch is much nicer than it was. It actually, I can do it with one finger, you know. So yeah, let's get some more clean up here. Let's get this pad back on here. The 45 adapter, as you can see right there, and let's see how far we have come. All right, we're gonna try some 91% alcohol on that, and. Should I get you guys in this whole shot here? Hold on. Let's give this a try. This alcohol does wonders. But you want to stay away from your black lettering because it will remove that too. It's just old glue from maybe a piece of masking tape. But it's been on there for a long time because you could see the discoloration as to where the glue was at. But, yeah. Gotta love that strong alcohol. But, yeah, it's gone. And, again, stay away from this black print, because this alcohol will remove it. Hold on. See that crud over there? That was giving me some trouble with the Windex, so let's make that go away. Look at that. See that? I'm like, wow. I guess the best way to do this is to fire it up and just let it spin it. What do you say? Do I have this unplugged? No, I need to turn it on. Just let that run, like so. Just hold your alcohol rag right next to it. Maybe just move it up and down a little bit at a time. Get rid of all that crap on there. All right. Pretty damn good right there. Looks really good. Nice and white. Just a quick little run down here and check our tone arm. Wipe down with some alcohol. Looking pretty good there. Alright. I say, now, let's have a look at this thing. Was actually intended to do. Let me put this in a neutral position. What do I mean by that? If 78, 45 neutral of course stops it, 33 and 16. I've never even seen a 16 RPM record. Doesn't mean they don't exist, I just never seen one. Alright. We're gonna fire this up. So we're gonna select viewer. Which is the farthest. See the light bulb come on? Right there. There's a light bulb in there. Let's see if we can get this, well, we can't get it propped up too much because we have to have a flat surface for the record. And we have, today, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be watching Donald Duck. You like that when I said that? Wow, I don't know. That's pretty funky, huh? Maybe that needs to be wiped down with a little Windex. And then we have our viewer cartridge, we'll call that, or cassette, or whatever. Stick that in there like so. Yeah, let me give this a little bit of a quick wipe down. That thing is funky. Wow, is that thing funky. They don't look bad, they just look like they've been kind of neglected, you know? Alright. So I think that this is the show and tell site. Old MacDonald had a farm. Oh, Old MacDonald had a farm. I don't know. What side is that? This side? This side is the show and tell site. Alright. So we say get to it. Oh yeah, I see there's an image down here. Let me turn these lights off. Let me outen the lights, as they say. And then, see. Fire this up. 33 and a third. And,
Old Mr. True Nose, the zookeeper, was waiting for his vacation, and Donald Duck was taking his place. Remember now, Mr. True Nose said, keep a sharp eye on the animals. Morning, noon, and night, especially at night. And most important of all, make sure the animals are always fed on time.
Right,
said Donald. They shook hands and Mr. True Nose left. That night, Donald, true to his word, made an inspection tour of the zoo. How eerie everything was in the moonlight. The eyes of the lions and tigers and panthers gleamed like blue flames. A timber wolf howled. Once, he sat down on an old log to rest, but suddenly it began to move, straight for the little pond.
Wait!
Cried Donald, as he realized he'd been sitting on an alligator. Another time, he sat down on a rock, but after a moment, the rock, too, began to move. The rock was an enormous sea turtle. Then, Donald went into the birdhouse, where birds of every kind from every corner of the world glared and screamed at him.
Stop watching me!
Donald said to the birds in their cages.
I'm supposed to be watching you.
Woo-hoo, said an old owl.
You, who do you think?
But the owl only answered, woo-hoo. Suddenly, thump, Donald had bumped into something. A huge, hulking shadow, and it moved.
Who are you?
Donald quavered. Bazooka the bear, a gruff voice replied. I've been in this crummy zoo long enough. I'm leaving.
How did you get out of your cage?
Slipped out while old True Nose was cleaning it out this morning. Never missed me. Now, I'm taking your key so I can turn the mother bears loose. And what's more, I'm locking you up in the wild bird cage, where nobody can tell you apart from any other duck. Then, Bazooka hung a sign on the bird cage. It said, Extra Wild Duck. Now, try to convince people you're the zookeeper. Next day, the zoo visitors, including Bazooka, came to the wild bird cage to laugh at the wild duck who claimed he was the zookeeper. The wilder Donald became, the more they all laughed. He's extra wild, all right, they said. Later, Mickey Mouse visited the zoo and immediately recognized his old friend Donald. Poor Donald, said Mickey. How can I get you out of there?
You can't get the keys away from Bazooka the bear first.
Then he beckoned Mickey closer and whispered in his ear so no one could hear. Mickey nodded his head, walked away, then suddenly began calling, Feeding time! Feeding time! Come and get it! All at once, an amazing thing happened. Creatures of habit that they were, the bears immediately ran for their cages. Where is it? They drooled. Bazooka took the keys and opened the cages. All the bears ran inside. But so anxious was Bazooka to eat, that he quite forgot the keys, and left them in the lock. Quickly, Mickey slammed the cage shut, took the keys, and released his friend Donald. The bears were absolutely furious. We'll get you for this, they roared at Donald. But all the new zookeeper said was,
And that will conclude our story time for the day. Yeah, but it's nice to see that it works. It really is. So, there's a little cartridge there, as you can see. See the images inside. And it just advances because it's sitting on, there's some teeth right there. It moves on a gear. Let's see if you can see those teeth in there. Anyway, there's a set of teeth that run on that side and that side, the distance of this cartridge. And that's what advances it. So yeah, and this needle just rides on this ridge right here. It doesn't touch, just it kind of a weak, hokey system. It looks to me like it should lock right in there, but I don't think it does. It doesn't lock in there at all, just think it's that optimal resting position. Who knows? So let's have a listen to what's on this side. But I think we can go to the phonograph. Switch here for that. Turning that light bulb off. And, All right. Yeah, I don't know how much of that I'll get dinged for, but you know what? I really don't care. It was fun showing it off. So actually, that record cleaned up really nice. It was just a lot of dirt and crud on it. So, put this back in like so. Let's slide that out. Put our cartridge back in where it belongs. And there you are. Just like that. I see there was another model here that was didn't have a radio. See, this is a model. There's no radio dial here. And so that might have just been viewer and phono. So you just had the ability to play a record and do your viewer show and tell thing. But no radio. So somebody stepped up and got the radio on this one. Whoa. So yeah, there's a list of Christmas programs, children's classics. Yeah, I don't know. Quite a few of them. Well, we picked up a really cool record today. Legend of Sleepy Hollow. I should actually give that a turn on this thing for Halloween. And, you know what? I think I'm going to do that. I'm going to say goodbye to you now, and I'm going to leave you with a Legend of Sleepy Hollow story. And, enjoy. Alright guys, stay tuned for my outro. I'm going to leave you with Walt Disney's A Legend of the Sleepy Hollow. As you can see, right there. And, what great artwork on that album.
Listen to him.
Alright, here we go. I guess, wow, this is odd. Gotta get it spinning. Alright.
He has feet like shovels, walks like a crane, nose sticks out like a weather vane, lean and lanky and skin and bone, clothes a scarecrow would like to own. But with the ladies, he's right there, debonair and devilly care. He's no skitter, scatter brain, not old Ichabod Crane. Ichabod, our old boy, Ichabod, that hobbledy hoy, who's his own best pride and joy, Ichabod, Ichabod Crane. Now who's the town's ladies' man? Who gets around like nobody can? Well, it has to be none other than Ichabod, Ichabod Crane.
If we could but journey back to that period in American history when the city of Manhattan was but a market town, we would discover in one of those spacious coves which dot the shores of the Hudson, the little village of Tarrytown, and just beyond, a quiet, peaceful place, yet somehow mysterious for its legends of haunted tales and local superstitions. The best-known story, however, concerns a certain schoolmaster who once wandered these parts. Some say his spirit still haunts the vicinity. He was a most unusual man. To see him, one might well mistake him for some scarecrow. He was tall and lanky. His head was small and flat on top with a long nose, so that it looked like a weathercock perched upon his skinny neck. Altogether, he was such a sight, seldom to be seen in broad daylight. It was late one drowsy autumn afternoon when this strange figure first approached the little village of Sleepy Hollow. As usual, there was gathered at ye old Schnooker and Schnuff Shop a group of lads known as the Sleepy Hollow Boys. Their self-appointed leader, Brom Bones, was a burly, boisterous fellow, always ready for a fight or a frolic. And though Brom was given to practical jokes, still there was no malice in his mischief. Indeed, with his waggish humor and great strength, Brom Bones was quite the hero of all the country around. The schoolmaster's arrival gave rise to emotions. Everyone agreed they'd never seen anyone quite like Ichabod Crane. The schoolroom became his empire, over which, with lordly dignity, he ruled absolute. Ichabod was very conscientious, but was careful to administer justice to misbehaving schoolboys with discrimination. For it behooved him to keep on good terms with his pupils, especially if their mothers happened to be good cooks. So, as time went by, it may be seen that Ichabod got on well enough. He taught piano and singing in order to increase his slender income and to arouse the cultural interests of the sleepy village. It was only a matter of time before such a man as Ichabod would become an object of ridicule to Brom Bones and his gang. And yet, to Ichabod, these were small matters. Indeed, the schoolmaster possessed a remarkable calmness which remained quite undisturbed until that fateful day when his path was crossed by a woman, a certain woman, Katrina Van Tassel, daughter of old Baltus Van Tassel, the richest farmer in the country. She was a blooming lass, plump as a partridge, ripe, melting, and rosy-cheeked. And there was no doubt that fair Katrina was the richest prize in the countryside. And the schoolmaster, being an ambitious man, at once began to fill his mind with many sugary thoughts and hopeful dreams. Sweet Katrina, poor little rich girl, Ichabod longed to protect her. However, she was jealously guarded by a host of rustic admirers. But Ichabod was confident. But the schoolmaster failed to reckon with Brom Bones himself. Now the ease with which Brom cleared the field of rivals provoked the fair Katrina, and she often wished that some champion would appear and for once take the field openly against the boisterous Brom. And though a wiser man would have shrunk from competition, love, they say, is blind. And Ichabod was aware only that Dame Fortune was at last thundering at his door. It was upon the occasion of her father's annual Halloween frolic that Katrina chose to stir the embers of the smoldering rivalry she had created between Brom and Ichabod. Thus, her invitation to Ichabod carried a most personal summons. The worthy schoolmaster was in a state of joy. To him this could mean but one thing. Katrina had chosen him, he thought to himself. Well, tonight's the night. Just turn on the old charm, and the fair Katrina is yours for the asking. And so gaily bedecked and nobly mounted upon a borrowed horse, he went forth like a knight-errant of old to keep a tryst with his lady fair. In all the countryside, there was nothing to equal the merrymaking at Mynheer Van Tassel's farm. To Ichabod, here was a perfect field for his endeavors. Now, indeed, would he put his best foot forward, for beyond all his other talents, the schoolmaster prided himself upon his dancing. The unhappy Brom, already bested at every turn by Ichabod's manners and gentility, saw himself once more outmatched. For as he watched them dancing, he was forced to admit that here was a flawless picture of ease and grace. There was no doubt that Ichabod was the man of the hour. Brom knew he must concede his rival still another victory. And yet there was still a chance his time would come, for when it grew late, Van Tassel always called upon his guests to tell him ghostly tales of Halloween. And Brom knew there was no more firm believer in spooks and goblins than superstitious Ichabod Crane.
Now gather round while I elucidate on what happens outside when it gets late. Along about midnight, the ghosts and banshees get together for their nightly jamborees. There's ghosts with horns and saucer eyes, and some with fangs about this size, some short and fat, some tall and thin, and some don't even bother to wear their skin. I'm telling you, brother, it's a frightful sight to see what goes on in the night. have a midnight jamboree. If they break it up with fiendish glee, ghosts are bad, but the one that's cursed is the headless horseman. He's the worst. When he goes a-jogging across the land, holding his noggin in his hand, demons take one look and groan and hit the road for parts unknown. There's no backlight to smoke that's burned. They don't like him and he's really burned. Swears through the longest day he's dead. He'd show them that he can tell our head. All the windows and lock the doors. Unless you're careful, he'll get yours. Don't think he hesitate a bit, cause he'll rip your top if it'll fit. And he's like some little, but like some big. Park in the middle or away. Black or white or even red, the headless horseman needs a head. With a hip, hip and a hippity clock, he's out looking for a head job. So don't stop to figure out a plan. You can't reason with a headless man.
It was the very witching hour of night that Ichabod started homeward. The sky grew darker and darker as, one by one, the stars winked out their lights, and driving clouds obscured the moon from sight. Never had the schoolmaster felt so melancholy, so utterly alone, and the nearer he approached the hollow, the more dismal he became. Once inside the murky glen, Ichabod's anxiety increased 100-fold, and now the forest seemed to close in behind him, and every small detail of Brahm's awful story returned to haunt his recollection. For once you've crossed the bridge, the ghost is through, his power ends. Ichabod rode along, trying to whistle away his fears. Oh, if only his horse would hurry up and come to that bridge. The woods grew blacker and blacker. He whipped his horse into a faster gallop, sweat streaming from his brow. As they came abreast of the graveyard, he reined to a screeching halt, as there, among the tombstones, was a rider on a horse. The horse reared and silhouetted against the sky. Ichabod saw the rider was headless. With a blood-curdling laugh, the horseman started after Ichabod, throwing his great sword in the air. Sparks flew from the horse's hooves, and the chase was on. Uphill, down dale, the horseman ever gaining on poor Ichabod. Oh, where was that bridge? Just as the road dipped down to the bridge approach, there suddenly was the headless horseman blocking Ichabod's path. Ichabod turned tail as quickly as his old horse could, and barely missed another well-aimed swipe from the dreadful sword. He rolled again around a rise, and once more tried for the bridge. He fancied he could feel the black steed's hot breath, and turning around was horrified to see him right on his heels. Ichabod was staring into the flaming pumpkin head, which the horseman held under his arm. With a shriek of terror, Ichabod plunged onto the bridge and galloped across. He gained the opposite side and turned to look to see if he was safe. He saw the ghastly specter arise in his stirrups and hurl his fiery head right at Ichabod. He tried to duck, but too late. It hit his head with a great crash, and he tumbled headlong into the dust. Next morning, Ichabod's hat was found, and close beside, a shattered pumpkin. But there was no trace of the schoolmaster. It was shortly thereafter that Bomb Bones led the fair Katrina to the altar. Now, rumors persisted that Ichabod was still alive, married to a wealthy widow in a distant county. But of course, the good Dutch settlers refused to believe such nonsense, for they knew the schoolmaster had been spirited away by the headless horseman.
Oh, close all the windows and lock the doors. Unless you're careful, he'll get yours. Black or white or even red, the headless horseman needs a head. With a hip, hip and a hippity clock, he's out looking for a head to jock. So don't stop to figure out a plan. You can't reason with a headless man.
All right. Happy Halloween, everybody.